another, trying to find out the organism and look that. The most important as for scaling here, time is very short, so I have to finish it fast. This is a high iron in atom liver value. The bleeding characteristics, magnitude is undefined, one knows how many people bleeds. And it's an anti-thrombotic as well as pro-thrombotic state. It's a mixture of that. And if you do a thrombotic elastography, the overall hemostasis in atom liver value is normal. So don't treat the high INR prophylactically. It's a criminal offense, let me tell you. It's there in all books for last 7 years now. Accepted throughout the world. So even if you get an INR of 1.0, you are doing invasive procedures, you have to give it. You are doing a cytic tap, the whole world is dividing into two. Ranier says, don't give prophylactic therapy for a cytic tap, but half of the world says no, give also for a cytic tap. But you are doing a intracellular pressure monitoring, you are putting it. The catheter there, then you have to do that. You are doing a central line, you have to do the prophylactic that. Correction of pseudo strength in the INR and important prognostic marker. As I said, if the INR is, suppose now it's 4.5, then it goes up, goes high to 6 tomorrow morning, that means patient is bad. So that factor will go into treat then. Dropout is studying, you give a lot of effective, you develop a transmission related atom blast injury and one of one load. So prior to invasive procedure and vitamin K, you give it regularly. Contaminant factor 7A is very important in some of the patients. Before putting a bar hole, you can do that. But it's worth every penny, as most of the Western world also believes. For the volume replacement, it's always normal saline is better. Due to a dialysis, pulmonary arterial catheterization is not important or not required, and you need a lot of non-adjective, try to avoid vasopressin. Sometimes you may need to add dialysis. Metabolic acidosis, you need a lot of N-acetylcysteine, but that's very important, I'll come to that, what N-acetylcysteine does. Let's come to the specific etiology. Now, N-acetylcysteine in paracetamol poison, you know that 20 tablets of paracetamol, mostly better if you don't treat them. If you treat them, they are not better. Now, do I say 6 tablets in a cirrhotic patient, even 3 grams of paracetamol can kill your patient, especially after the invent of so many injectable paracetamol, you are giving 1 gram 6 soli. Unfortunately, I lost a patient at the beginning of when the drug came, 1 gram 6 soli post-surgery. The surgeon went on leaving, I didn't see the chart. With my surprise that in spite of best effort, I missed the chart. The patient died within a day with the acute liver failure. I put on chronic liver failure here as a cirrhotic. So very high acidity, low bilirubin rise in absence of hypotension or serious collapse suggests paracetamol poison. Not in 5% dextrose, 9 mg full loading dose. This is 1 gram. You have available like Mucinac. These are available in 5 ml ampoule. This is available widely in Calcutta. I use it very regularly. Where I tell you. 9 ampoule loading over 15 minutes and 5% exposure, 3 ampoules over 4 hours and 6 hours in next 16 hours. Now, N-acetylcysteine has been used in early stage non-acetylcysteine acute liver injury in adults as well as children. The results are very good. And why, how does it work? It improves microcirculation, anti-inflammatory effects, and improves oxygen carrying capacity. It is antioxidant, basically, it gives it an N-acetyl derivative of cysteine, increases the energy pH level and glutathione. Now, DILI is best, HBB is best. So, indication of N-acetyl cysteine, besides paracetamol, paracetamol is drug-induced liver injury and hepatitis B virus, acute liver failure, rather than autoimmune or indeterminate etiology. Now you use it very early and in first phase and in grade 1 of the 8 community, ideally than 3 and 4. Again the dose is similar and go over for next 3 days. This has been used also in childhood 2008 in children with non-acetamol induced paracetamol, non-paracetamol poisoning. A lot of drugs can cause acute liver injury. I have seen with statin, I have seen with ciprofloxacin, I have seen with amiodarone, I have seen with valproic acid, and so on. So many drugs, so you should be careful which drug patient is on and can cause acute liver failure. Viral hepatitis A to E, there's no treatment. For hepatitis B, you start giving nucleoside analog. My patient is 610 and entecavir. In acute liver failure, initially the bilirubin level was considered 20. Now it is considered throughout the world as 10. So you have acute liver failure, hepatic encephalopathy, hepatitis B positive, acute infection, IgM and TSBC positive. The bilirubin of more than 10, you must give entecavir or tenofovir. Now, harmless virus is treated with acyclovir. For Wilson's, there is no choice but liver transplant. For autoimmune hepatitis, you do a liver biopsy and start with steroid. If liver biopsy has to be done, it has to be done transtubular. Now, fatty liver pregnancy, need to do a termination of pregnancy. So you don't need to know the etiology. Liver biopsy is very, very important, but you have to do a transfusula. I am not going to liver transplant. So liver transplant is a bridge or spontaneous recovery. So you need to do a liver support to bridge to transplant or a spontaneous recovery. The liver support, so many systems have been tried for the last 20, 30 years. In fact, 1950s onwards, but nothing has been successful. Even mass is not successful. So initial enthusiasm on mass has gone. So you go for liver transplant. Still not available very well in our city, but we can have a lot of data in our country has come and improved survival in grade 1, grade 2, 80% to 90%. The stakes are really high in medical practice. It's very, very important, and that's very important. See, suppose the child has developed acute liver failure, you are giving a transplant. Now, whole life he has to continue the immunosuppression, and probably or possibly or something, if you don't have a very good strong indication, the child would have survived without a transplant. So in our country, in such a poor country, it's really very difficult. So you give benefit from transplant, some small amount of them, and if you do them, again, a little bit of them will be really benefited. So we have to decide that. Now, so is it legal? I'll take another instrument. Yes, I'm very sorry, very fast. So what we did for this patient? So intravenous normal saline, non-epinephrine for the hypertension, lactulose, bowel was and gin, ventilator was put on, and then antibiotics, that was carbamazepine, proton pump inhibitors, vitamin K, no effect was given even with the INR of 3.8. He was put on intravenous as soon as we got IgM anti-HBC positive on day 7, and we started on antibiotics. And he was classical candidate for inacetylcysteine system, but I could not give it because of the legal issues and others which still does not accept everything. If your relative does not give a consent, you can't give a new drug. And liver transplant discussion in our area could not afford. He was discharged, he survived very well. Bilirubin came down to 12, INR was 1.2 and creatinine was 1. But sometimes the light at the end of the tunnel may not be like this, may not be a trend. You can get killed by such a treatment. So somebody is really a challenge. Management of ALL is a challenge. Rescue, physician, and intensive treatment for specific etiology and consumption of transcription should be undertaken urgently in all patients. So it's a multi-organ failure. Recognize how the determining etiology has to be treated. Intensive care, chemotherapy, treat your cerebral edema, infection, and multi-organ failure. Don't treat INR, please don't treat. And that is very, very promising. Treat etiology if identified and rich by liver support, and if you have a transplant, please do that. For our country, INR is the key. Colon transfer to their country and consider distance and transfer the patient to a liver transplant. Can you predict natural history of ALL? Possibly even Paul II will not be able to tell us what we'll be able to see. But try to use your brain, and then you may not have to jump and run out that you will fall in manual. Don't go back to your intelligences. You have so many medicines, so many ways to handle multi-organ failure. And constantly doctors keep on pray and try to put your patients and don't put your eaters, put your drugs on your side. And then change is inevitable. Every day, every month you take new drugs to be ready to do it again. Adapt yourself to the newer therapies. And then you will be able to help yourself and the patient. I really thank to the patients who have talked to me over the last 30 years nearly now, respected audience, really beautiful gallery here. I was really surprised listening to all talks. I learned so many things from abdominal compartment syndrome from Ashunda, as well as the obstetrician cares. I was really going through that. And pneumonia also. I always thank my wife and son who teaches me every day how to do. And please don't forget this gentleman, he's a modern Gandhi. You need to put your Nike shoes, put your hat in the different way, carry on your mobile, so you modify yourself. Your science is different, so modify yourself. Be a little feluga. You don't know where to reach. You have crossed a lot of paths, but you need to reach the top, you don't know where is the top. And best woman in this world must be Mahadurga, who has 10 weapons in hand to kill Joshu. So if you have 10 weapons in your hand, I think you can kill acute liver failure or other organisms or other disease. And then we have a little calm and you will enjoy. Thank you all.